Good morning. I'm the Reverend Amy Richter. I am here with the Reverend Joe Pagano at the Lomond River at Stuckless Pond Trail in Gros Morne National Park. This is a service of morning prayer for Sunday, January 31st. Thank you to all the parishioners who helped us make this service, and thank you very much for joining us today. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, verses 15 to 20. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, If I hear the voice of the Lord my God any more, or ever again see this great fire, I shall die. Then the Lord replied to me, They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, or who presumes to speak in my name a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Glorify the Lord, all you works of the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
In the firmament of his power, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
Glorify the Lord, you angels and all powers of the Lord, all heavens and all waters above the heavens.
Sun and moon and stars of the sky, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
Glorify the Lord, every shower of rain and fall of dew, all winds and fire and heat.
Winter and summer, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
Glorify the Lord, O chill and cold, drops of dew and flakes of snow.
Frost and cold, ice and sleet, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
Glorify the Lord, O nights and days, O shining light and enfolding dark.
Storm clouds and thunderbolts, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
Let us glorify the Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
In the firmament of his power, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
Put your hand in the hand of the man who still held the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who called on the sea. Take a look at yourself and you can look at others differently. Put your hand in the hand of the man come together with me. Take a look at yourself.
A reading from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed and kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching? With authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Jesus was a great teacher. Perhaps this is an obvious point, right? Jesus gave us the Sermon on the Mount. He taught us the Golden Rule. He told us that the greatest commandment is to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Our gospel lesson for today, however, makes this point about Jesus as teacher in a startling way. It clearly intends to highlight Jesus as teacher. So, Jesus, along with Peter and Andrew and James and John, had gone to Capernaum. And when Sabbath came, we are told, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. He must have impressed, because Mark says the people in the synagogue were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. And yet, what really grabs people's attention is what happens next. A man with an unclean spirit cries out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." And in response, Jesus rebukes the unclean spirit, tells him to be silent and come out of the man, and the unclean spirit does. Now, as someone who has spent a lot of time as a classroom teacher, I must say, I am really impressed. I suppose there's nothing quite like an exorcism to keep students focused during a lecture. Even better than telling them that the next bit is going to be on the exam. Jesus casts out an unclean spirit, and we are told they were all amazed and kept asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority?" This is so much better than a PowerPoint presentation, much more effective than a brainstorming session. Jesus casts out a demon, and his fame as a teacher spreads throughout Galilee. Now, Mark clearly intends us to understand everything that happened in the synagogue that day as teaching. And this may puzzle us. Part of our puzzlement may be due to pictures of teachers that we have in our minds, at least of the good ones. Good teachers, we may think, are not only brilliant people who know their subject matter, but are also good communicators. And the good ones also seem to care about their students. They have an ability to engage students, to empathize with their thoughts and concerns, to get close to them. You know the type, right? Button-down shirts, cardigan sweaters, wire-rimmed glasses, loafers. Jesus does not fit our picture of a good teacher. I seriously doubt he would be interested in the music the kids were listening to these days. I really don't think he would have invited students to address him using his first name. He would have been a holy terror at faculty meetings. We may, however, get some sense of the type of teacher Jesus was if we think not of the good teachers we've had, but of those few, rare, great teachers who have actually changed our lives. Now, in contrast to good teachers who, because of their concern for students, draw close to them, great teachers always keep some distance between themselves and students because of their loyalty to a larger truth. Great teachers are slightly off-putting, maybe even a little scary, because our human default setting is to look for the easiest way to the truth. And we would much prefer to stick with our assumptions than to engage in the often painful process of rethinking and change. Great teachers are willing to forego us liking them so that we have the space to examine our lives in light of the demands of truth, so that we have the space in which genuine transformation can take place. But as we know, change can be scary. And change can be painful. So we try to avoid it, even when we know deep down that we need to. Even when we know that we need to let go of the ideas and the habits and the fears that are diminishing and destroying our lives. Great teachers don't let us get away with it. Great teachers challenge and confront us with the truth that they serve beyond all else. And it is in light of the truth, sometimes scary, always demanding, that genuine transformation can take place. The truth may set us free, but nobody said it would be easy. Great teachers, loyal to the truth beyond all else, are powerful people who can change lives. Jesus was a great teacher, someone utterly devoted to the truth he proclaimed. He was also probably a little bit frightening. He came on the scene proclaiming, "The kingdom of God has drawn near. Repent and believe in the good news." Above all else, Jesus was devoted to the truth of God's reign. So when Jesus taught, he exposed people to the power and brightness of God's presence. And in the power of that presence, in the power of that message, people's preconceptions and prejudices were laid bare. and fell away. People felt themselves exposed and stripped of their defenses. In the teaching of Jesus, not just a good teacher, but a great teacher, people were called to change, to renewal, to genuine transformation. It is in this sense, I think, that we may understand Jesus casting out an unclean spirit as part of his teaching. I must admit, as a teacher, I really love this part. Recall, Jesus was teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum when an unruly young man starts screaming at the top of his lungs, "What do you have to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us?" And now, as folks in the education business might say, Jesus has got himself a classroom management problem. Most teachers who have spent any time in the classroom have probably attended a faculty workshop on best practices for diffusing adversarial situations. Speaking the language of professional educators, we might draw on the latest theories of human development and the latest techniques for managing students who have problems with authority figures. But later on, at the lunch table or in the faculty lounge, when we were just talking among ourselves, we would revert to implicit theories of demon possession. We would say things about our students like, "What has gotten in to that young man today?" Or, "What crawled up inside of him and died?" When some student starts acting up in the middle of a long semester, we don't want a theory and we don't want a technique. We want an exorcist. If you have spent any significant time in the classroom, I bet at some point in your career, you spoke like someone who still believes in exorcism, or at least wishes it were an option. So, notice, in the synagogue, when Jesus is teaching and the man with the unclean spirit starts screaming, Jesus does not calmly explain to him why his behavior is inappropriate. Jesus does not go on to explain the consequences that will follow if the man continues with his inappropriate behavior. No, Mark tells us Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent, come out of him." To put this in more modern terms, Jesus said, "Shut up and get out." Now, my friends, that is what I call classroom management. And Mark says, the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. Those were the days. No trying to understand where the student is coming from. No saying things like, "Gee, Johnny, it sounds like you're really upset about something." No invitation to meet and talk after class. Just shut up and get out. Jesus was a great teacher, powerful teacher, someone who could transform lives with his powerful message. And all the people in the synagogue were amazed and exclaimed, "What is this? A new teaching with authority." One of the reasons why people come to church, I think, is because we are searching for answers to life's big questions. Searching for reasons why things happen the way they do. Searching for some sense of meaning in the midst of the confusions of late modern life. Things seem so chaotic and confused that many of us are miserable. There is so much that seems out of kilter, chaotic, and frightening in our world that we may sympathize with that poor, demented man screaming his head off in the synagogue. We have been bombarded with facts and figures. We have been overloaded with information. What we need is not more information, but rather to somehow see the larger picture, to see the larger pattern to help us navigate the tricky terrain of modern life. What we need is a teacher, a great teacher, someone with genuine power and authority. We are looking for a teacher who can help us change, who can restore us to sanity and wholeness. We are looking for a teacher who can calm our raging spirits, who can still our battered souls, who can fill us with a peace that passes understanding. We are looking for a great teacher. Lord Jesus Christ, our great teacher, speak words that calm our troubled souls and fill us with your peace. Amen.
Let us pray with confidence to the Lord, saying,
Lord, hear our prayer.
O Lord, guard and direct your church in the way of unity, service, and praise.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Give to all nations an awareness of the unity of the human family.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Cleanse our hearts of prejudice and selfishness, and inspire us to hunger and thirst for what is right.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach us to use your creation for your greater praise, that all may share the good things you provide.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Strengthen all who give their energy or skill for the healing of those who are sick in body or in mind.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Set free all who are bound by fear and despair.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant a peaceful end and eternal rest to all who are dying, and your comfort to those who mourn.
Lord, hear our prayer. Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you this day and always. Amen. go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.